Oh, hey there, it's Bee. Sorry, I was just reading about what Earth was like during the Carboniferous period, 300 million years ago. During this time, Earth was covered in swampy forests. And even though the Carboniferous period occurred way before humans evolved on Earth, this period in Earth's history turned out to be very important for modern humans. How can a time so long ago have anything to do with us today? Well, luckily for us, the Carboniferous period provided the perfect conditions to begin forming a resource which has powered our civilization for the last 250 years, coal. You probably know that human beings have been burning large amounts of coal and other fossil fuels since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. You've probably also heard that burning fossil fuels has increased the amount of carbon in the atmosphere. But I thought fossils were preserved remains of once living organisms. What do fossils have to do with fuels like coal? And if the increasing amount of carbon in the atmosphere is something scientists are concerned about, does that mean that carbon is bad for life? Not quite. In fact, life would not be possible without carbon. So, what's going on here? To figure it out, we need to learn more about carbon, an element which has a special place in my heart. Literally. By the end of this lesson, you'll be able to identify the properties of carbon atoms, explain why carbon is common in living things, and describe how carbon, life, and fossil fuels are related. First things first, what is carbon? Carbon is an element, so we can find it on the periodic table. There it is, number 6. Do you remember what an element's position on the periodic table tells us? The number of protons. So we know that all carbon atoms have 6 protons in their nuclei. Carbon atoms are the building blocks of many different molecules. Remember our Lego analogy for molecules and chemical reactions? Atoms are like Legos that can be stuck together to form a wide variety of molecules, which can be taken apart and reformed into new molecules through chemical reactions. If carbon atoms were Legos, they would be the most versatile Legos of all. And the reason for this relates to bonding. In an earlier lesson, we discussed how bonds connect atoms to form molecules. In this model of a dopamine molecule, the bonds are shown as gray sticks. But what exactly are bonds? Remember how atoms contain a nucleus surrounded by a cloud of electrons? It turns out that nuclei and electrons are attracted together because they have opposite charges. And when atoms come together, they can share outer electrons with other atoms to become more stable. In molecular models, each stick represents one pair of electrons being shared between two atoms. Let's look at a few simple examples, starting with hydrogen gas, or H2. This molecule is made of 2 hydrogen atoms bonded together. Since there's just one stick in the model, we know that each hydrogen atom is participating in one shared electron pair. Because just one pair of electrons is shared between these atoms, it is called a single bond. Hydrogen atoms prefer to share just one pair of electrons with another atom. Now, let's check out oxygen gas, or O2. This molecule is made of 2 oxygen atoms bonded together. Do you notice anything different between how H2 and O2 are bonded together? H2 is bonded together with a single bond, but O2 is connected with a double bond. This means that each oxygen atom participates in two shared pairs of electrons to become stable. Oxygen can also form two single bonds, for example, in water molecules. We can see in this H2O model that the oxygen atom is still involved in two shared electron pairs, and the hydrogen atoms are still involved in one shared pair. These patterns for hydrogen and oxygen hold in most cases. So, what about carbon? How many electron pairs do carbon atoms like to share? Take a look at this dopamine molecule and see if you notice a pattern across all of the carbon atoms. Remember that carbon atoms are represented as black. Pause the video while you look for the pattern. Each carbon atom in this molecule is participating in four shared electron pairs. Some of the carbons, such as this one, form four single bonds with other atoms. Other carbons, like this one, form a double bond and two single bonds. But every carbon is involved in four shared electron pairs. Carbon's ability to participate in four shared electron pairs makes it a very versatile building block, since it can combine in so many shapes and combinations. Carbon can form chains surrounded by hydrogen atoms, which are called hydrocarbons. Some hydrocarbons are short, like butane, a fossil fuel. Others are very long, like polyethylene, a common type of plastic. Carbon atoms can even form rings and branches, like this aspirin molecule. This molecule is not considered a hydrocarbon because it contains more than just carbon and hydrogen atoms. Can you tell what additional element is present? It's oxygen, and we can tell by their red color that four oxygen atoms are part of carbon-based aspirin molecules. But carbon rings aren't limited to aspirin. Graphite, the material in pencils, is made entirely of carbon rings bonded together in flat sheets. The sheets are easily rubbed onto paper, making graphite a good writing material. But pure carbon can bond together in different ways. Diamond, another substance made entirely of carbon, is bonded together in a crystal lattice structure, which holds the atoms together very tightly, making diamond the hardest natural material on Earth. Okay, so carbon atoms are versatile because they can bond with up to four atoms, and carbon-based molecules exist in a wide variety of shapes and sizes. But why does this matter for life? Because life is complicated. The periodic table contains 118 known elements. However, we and other living things are made almost entirely of only a few of these elements. As this pie chart shows, 62% of the atoms that make up our bodies are hydrogen and 24% are oxygen. Much of the hydrogen and oxygen is in the form of H2O, as water makes up a large percentage of our bodies. The third most common element in our bodies is carbon. 12% of the atoms in our bodies are carbon atoms. Carbon is so important that an entire branch of chemistry called organic chemistry is devoted to understanding how carbon-based molecules behave. Organic chemistry was given its name because in the 1800s, most of the carbon-based molecules that scientists knew of came from living organisms. Organisms are complex, so they require large, complex molecules to function and survive. And for the reasons discussed earlier, carbon is the ideal building block for these complex molecules. Large carbon-based molecules that exist in living things are called biological macromolecules. We will learn more about different types of biological macromolecules in the next two lessons. All life on Earth contains carbon. And like water, scientists think it is unlikely that non-carbon-based life exists anywhere in the universe, Based on our current understanding, no other element can act as the backbone for all the large and complex molecules which make up living things. So, if we do ever find life on another planet, it is very likely it will contain lots of carbon, just like you and I do. Now that we know more about carbon, let's return to our initial questions about fossil fuels. First, why is coal considered a fossil fuel? And what does it have to do with living things? Coal isn't living, or at least not anymore. Let's head back to the Carboniferous period 300 million years ago. Earth's land is covered in warm, swampy forests full of tall trees. As the plants grow, they use energy from sunlight to perform photosynthesis, a combination of chemical reactions which create carbon-based molecules. In addition to carbon, these molecules contain a lot of chemical potential energy, meaning that they can react at a later time and release energy. These trees had shallow roots and would commonly fall over, dying and settling underwater on the swampy forest floor. Over time, lots of dead plant material settled in the wet environment, eventually getting buried under layers of water, soil, and rock. Through millions of years of heat and pressure, the dead plant material transformed into coal. The coal, along with its carbon and chemical potential energy, are stored between layers of rock. This is why coal is called a fossil fuel, because it formed from the remains of once living plants. Coal contains the original carbon present in the trees when they died. Coal contains so much carbon, in fact, that the element carbon received its name from the Latin word for coal, carbo. And the Carboniferous period was named for the large amount of carbon-rich coal which began to form at that time. Humans have been extracting coal and burning it for more than 250 years. Coal is a useful energy source because of its high chemical potential energy. When burned in the presence of oxygen gas, the carbon-rich molecules in the coal react, forming new molecules and releasing energy. And humans have used that energy for transportation, heat, and electricity, allowing the modern civilization that we enjoy today to develop. But unfortunately, energy is not the only thing released when coal is burned. In addition to coal ash waste, coal combustion also releases carbon dioxide gas, CO2. Carbon dioxide forms when the carbon-rich molecules in coal break apart, freeing carbon atoms to react with oxygen gas in the air and form a new molecule. CO2 itself is not bad for life. In fact, life on Earth could not exist without it. Plants absorb carbon dioxide from the air to perform photosynthesis, which is how the trees during the Carboniferous period got their carbon to begin with. Both plants and animals also release carbon dioxide as a product of cellular respiration. We exhale CO2 every time we breathe out. CO2 plays another key role in the biosphere. It helps keep Earth warm enough to support life. It is a type of greenhouse gas which traps heat around Earth like a blanket, along with other greenhouse gases like H2O and CH4. Some heat trapping is good. Life on Earth would freeze without it. But we have burned so much coal and other fossil fuels that we have increased the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere significantly. This means more trapped heat and ultimately a changed climate. Earth's climate has changed before, but never before due to human activities, and as far as scientists can tell, not as fast as it is changing today. Evidence from fossils, ice cores, soil cores, and more tells us that the last time CO2 levels were as high as they are today was millions of years ago. The global climate at that time was warmer, and sea levels were significantly higher due to less ice existing at the poles. Humans, as well as many other species alive today, have evolved to live in the stable climate of the last 10,000 years. Neither today's species nor our modern civilization are prepared for significantly different conditions. Rapid climate change could threaten the survival of species that are not adapted to different conditions and cannot adapt or relocate fast enough. This includes humans. Humans and other species around the world are already experiencing effects of climate change, and they will only continue to worsen if we do not make changes. Coal is the dirtiest energy source by far, emitting more pollution and carbon dioxide than all other sources. For this reason, it is already being phased out. However, we still have a lot of work to do to replace coal and other fossil fuels with carbon-free energy sources like nuclear, solar, and wind. Utilizing these cleaner sources of energy will allow us to keep more carbon in the ground where it does not enter the atmosphere or affect the climate. We can also return carbon to the ground by protecting and restoring ecosystems that absorb CO2, particularly forests and grasslands. The goal is not to remove all CO2 from the atmosphere, but to restore the carbon balance that has kept our climate stable for millions of years and has allowed our species to flourish. We now know that carbon atoms are versatile building blocks which can bond with up to 4 atoms. Carbon provides the structure for the large, complex molecules needed for life. And fossil fuels contain lots of carbon because they formed from once living organisms. In the next few lessons, we'll explore some important types of carbon-based molecules which allow life to function. Until then, remember, biology is more than just science. It's the way of life. Hey!